Welcome to the deep dive. Today, we're zeroing in on chronic stable angina.
Right. It's a condition many have heard of, but might not fully understand.
Exactly. It's a really common sign that something's going on with your heart's oxygen balance.
And we've basically sifted through the medical info to pull out the key things you need to know.
Our mission for this deep dive is pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Give you a clear picture of what it is, why it happens, how it feels, and, well, how doctors start looking into it. So let's get right to it then. What fundamentally is chronic stable angina?
Well, simply put, it's a signal. A signal that your heart muscle isn't getting quite enough oxygen for the amount of work it's actually doing at that moment.
An imbalance.
Precisely. A mismatch between oxygen supply and oxygen demand.
Okay. So what kind of things reduce that oxygen supply? What are the main culprits?
There are several factors. Probably the most common one is the size of the blood vessels feeding the heart. They get narrowed.
Usually atherosclerosis, right? That plaque buildup.
Exactly. Atherosclerosis is a big one. Less space means less blood can get through. Sometimes the vessels can also suddenly clamp down. That's called vasospasm.
Oh, okay.
That also restricts flow. And interestingly, even just a fast heart rate tachycardia can reduce supply.
How does that work?
Well, the heart muscle gets most of its blood between beats during the diastolic phase. Mm-hmm. If the heart's beating really fast, there's just less time in that phase.
Less filling time. Makes sense.
Right. And finally, sometimes it's about the blood itself. If you don't have enough oxygen in the blood, like with hypoxemia, or not enough red blood cells to carry anemia, that also reduces the supply getting to the heart muscle.
Okay, that covers the supply side pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
What about the other side of the equation? When does the heart demand more oxygen?
Good question. The biggest driver is increased heart rate. So think about exercise, obviously,
mm-hmm.
or even things like stress or an overactive thyroid gland, hyperthyroidism. That makes the heart beat faster, demanding more fuel.
More work, more oxygen needed.
Exactly. And it's not just rate. It's also how forcefully the heart contracts. That can also increase with hyperthyroidism, for instance, burns more oxygen.
Okay.
And then there's something called wall stress. Basically, the tension within the heart muscle itself.
Wall stress.
Yeah. If the heart muscle gets bigger, like with myocardial hypertrophy, or if it's pumping against resistance, like with a narrowed aortic valve, aortic stenosis, that increases the tension and therefore the oxygen demand.
Right. So it's working harder in different ways.
You got it.
So we've covered the why, the supply and demand issues. Now, how does this actually show up? What are the key signs and symptoms someone should look out for?
The classic presentation is what doctors call typical angina. This is usually a discomfort, maybe tightness, pressure, squeezing.
Behind the breastbone?
Yes, retrosternal is the term. Behind the breastbone. And it often radiates, you know, spreads to the left arm, maybe the shoulder, neck, or jaw.
And other feelings too.
Yeah, people might also get sweaty, feel nauseous, maybe a bit anxious. The really key thing is the trigger.
The three E's.
You know it. Exertion, strong emotion, or sometimes eating a heavy meal. Those are common triggers. And importantly, the discomfort is usually brief.
How brief?
Typically less than, say, 10 or 15 minutes. And it gets better with rest or with medication like nitroglycerin.
Okay, that's typical. You mentioned atypical angina earlier.
Right. Atypical angina just means it meets two of those typical criteria we just discussed, the location quality, the triggers, and the relief with rest nitrates.
And if it only meets one or none?
Then it's generally classified as non-cardiac chest pain. But, you know, any new or worsening chest discomfort really needs checking out regardless of the label.
Absolutely. Are there any other sort of physical clues?
Sometimes people instinctively make a fist and hold it over their chest when they describe the pain. That's a classic sign called Levine sign.
Interesting.
Also, sometimes the heart's oxygen shortage doesn't cause pain at all. It might show up as sudden shortness of breath or signs of heart failure, like fluid backing up into the lungs. We call those anginal equivalents.
So, not pain, but still a sign of the same underlying problem.
Exactly.
What are the first steps a doctor usually takes?
Well, it always starts with a good chat, a thorough medical history. Talking about the symptoms, your lifestyle, your risk factors, and a physical exam, of course.
Listening to the heart, checking blood pressure.
All of that. Then usually some basic blood tests. Things like checking your hemoglobin for anemia, blood sugar, cholesterol levels, and making sure kidneys, liver, thyroid are working okay.
Standard checks. What about heart-specific tests?
An ECG electrocardiogram is fundamental. It looks at the heart's electrical activity. Ideally, you'd get one while resting, and if possible, actually during an episode of the chest pain.
To see the changes.
Right, and sometimes a chest x-ray is helpful, especially if heart failure or maybe a lung issue is suspected.
It really does underscore how vital it is to listen to your body and get things checked if they don't feel right.
Absolutely.
What other questions does this raise for you about keeping your heart healthy? Thanks for diving deep with us today.